Good evening to everyone present for this webinar. It is an honor to host this beautiful audience who has gathered virtually today. I welcome you all on behalf of Vignans Foundation for Science, Technology and Research. On this day celebrated as International Day for Women and Girls in Science, for the webinar organized by Vignan Civil Services Academy and Vignans Women Development and Empowerment Cell. This is a part of the series of webinars that the Civil Services Academy has planned, and the forthcoming event is on 20th February on the occasion of International Day for Social Justice. Science and gender equality are both vital for the well-being of human society. The Sustainable Development Goal 5 aims to achieve gender equality and empower all women and girls. But however, according to the UNESCO data, only around 30% of all female students select STEM-related fields in higher education. Globally, female students' enrollment is particularly low in ICT, natural science, mathematics, statistics, engineering, manufacturing, and construction. As an initiative to achieve full and equal access to and participation in science for women and girls, along with women empowerment, this day, that is February 11th, is celebrated as International Day for Women and Girls in Science by United Nations General Assembly since 2015. This year is the 6th International Day for Women and Girls in Science with the theme Women Scientists at the Forefront of the Fight Against COVID-19. The theme aims to celebrate contribution of women scientists in fighting the pandemic. At the global level, many women have played a significant role and made immense contribution in the fight against COVID-19. Not only women, but young girls like Anika Chabrolu, an Indian American, has contributed by working on a potential drug to treat COVID-19. She has won 3 million Young Scientist Award too. We have gathered here to celebrate such contributions, and on this occasion, with immense pleasure, I welcome today's guest, Dr. Uma Kanga, Assistant Professor, Department of Transplant Immunology and Immunogenetics, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Welcome, Madam. I also welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. M.Y.S. Prasad. I also take a moment to welcome our Head Training Cell, Chairperson, Women Development and Empowerment Cell, Head Humanities Division, Dean Student Affairs, other dignitaries, my colleagues, and my young friends to this webinar. We hope this webinar creates awareness and motivates the participants to choose STEM-related fields in higher education. I am sure it is going to be a great hour of interaction and learning for all of us. Now, I would like to request Mr. C. Raghav Rao, Head Training Cell, to introduce the guest speaker, Dr. Uma Kanga, to our audience. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Meenakshi. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. Uma Kanga. Uma Kanga is Assistant Professor in the Department of Transplant Immunology and Immunogenetics, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. She is PhD. She received many fellowships, mainly Commonwealth Fellowship from UK, Japanese Society of Promotion of Science, Japanese Ministry of Science and Culture. Not only that, she has to her credit Mentor Mentee Award from Transplantation Society, European Federation of Immunogenetics, American Association of Immunologists. She has 70 publications to her credit. She is instrumental in getting 4 crore research grant from ICMR, DBT, CSIR, INSERM, and All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Apart from this, she acted as Secretary, Indian Society for Histocompatibility and Immunogenetics, Vice President, Asia-Pacific Histocompatibility and Immunogenetics Association, and her research interests are transplant in immunology, genetic diversity of HLA genes, and molecular basis of disease susceptibility. So may I request Dr. Uma Kanga to address the gathering. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. At the outset, I would like to thank the Vice Chancellor, sir, Prasad, sir, the Dean, all the HODs, Raghav Rao, sir, and the organizing committee for giving me an opportunity to present some work that the women in this world have contributed towards handling COVID pandemic. I'm really humbled by the introduction given for me, and I'm grateful that I have this opportunity to highlight what other people are doing in this world, and to I hope that we can encourage youngsters, students, both girls and boys, to learn from this and how much contribution women have made. Prasad sir told us how difficult it is for women. No matter, sir, despite all the odds, women have been doing great. And like you appreciate women, I will highlight the contributions in terms of COVID-19. And I hope I'm doing justice to, I must at the outset say that if I have missed any names or anybody is listening, I pardon me. I tried to assimilate as much as I could, given the time that I had at this short notice. So I was given the topic to speak about women scientists at the forefront of fight against the COVID-19. And this picture is from of my institute. This is my alma mater where I've studied. I did my PhD from this department, and I am now serving as a faculty over here. Spent like 3 decades almost in this department. So COVID-19 and the pandemic started almost a year ago, when in India we and globally everyone got to know what is there is some viral infection spreading, and people started writing in the newspapers, in the televisions, and in the journals, people started mentioning what is this a killer virus. And then very soon we learned that there is a complex biology powering the coronavirus pandemic. And scientists were trying to figure out what is happening. And this picture is a glimpse of all the kind of correlations that we had from its origin and how the disease is manifesting and how people are trying to manage it. So let me just tell you that since we are going to be talking about women, when I started learning, reading about the women contributions, I discovered myself that I was not aware that there was a BBC news which mentioned that the women are the ones who actually have, discovered this. There is a lady behind this discovery of the coronavirus. She was a Scottish woman, June Alameda, Dr. June Alameda. You can see her in the picture at an electron microscope in the Cancer Institute in Toronto. She is the one who pioneered the virus imaging, and she found out that there is a virus called coronavirus. She left school and then did her formal education, got a job, and then started the job as a laboratory technician in histopathology at Glasgow. And then she moved to London, where she was able to identify this coronavirus. So the women have started contributing to this coronavirus. If you look at Wikipedia, you will see this picture, and I'm sure all women must have seen this picture. All women or all attendees would have definitely seen this picture many multiple times. So this is the virus, and this is how the classification of the virus is mentioned on the Wikipedia. Today, it's not the focus of the talk, so I'm not going to be speaking on all the details about the virus, but I'm supposed to be talking to you about how the women are contributing in this virus. So this is an image of the virus, how the structure of the virus looks like. And on the left bottom, you will see that how the virus can now be imaged using the electron microscopy. And on the right, you feel the image, which indicates that this is the spike protein homodimer. And the top in the purple, in the magenta color, is the receptor, the ACE2 binding domain, which binds to the cell surface, and how this virus enters the human body. So there are structural features. This virus has several protein molecules, S protein, E protein, membrane protein. So there are several types of coronaviruses that were identified, started with the common cold, and then we have the SARS, the MERS, and the SARS-CoV-2. So people had to find out what was the origin, and it was reported that the origin was bat, and then it went to an immediate host. Either in the MERS scenario, it was camel, in the SARS, it was cat, and then SARS-CoV-2 is the pangolin, and then it was transmitted to humans, and several factors are known how further transmission happened. Once the origin was identified, it was also reported that once it is transmitted to humans, people are getting hospitalized and the disease is spreading in the community, because we didn't know how to handle the virus. And later on, everybody realized how it is to be handled. So from individual to the community, it went on spreading and spreading, and we know globally how much it made a difference. So there were theories saying that it is an aerosol mediated, it is using the touch from a surface, it's a droplet. So a lot of precautions were to be taken, and finally people learned and the doctors learned how to manage this transmission and control the transmission of the coronavirus. And this is the scenario the global scenario, the John Hopkins University updates weekly. And you can see that in the map, that all the red dots are indicating as to where the pandemic and what was the impact of the pandemic. So globally, it made a very, very big difference. And all of us have gone through a very difficult time throughout the year. And now slightly relieved because things are under control and people are learning how to manage this. So how does the human body respond to it? So how we respond is that the immune system, our immune system is trained, and we have an innate immunity and an adaptive immunity. So our innate immune cells, like the dendritic cells and the NK cells, whenever there is a microbe, our body gets infected, our immune system immediately reacts within a few hours, and the innate immunity takes care of the initial pathogen load. And gradually, our adaptive immunity takes over. Our T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes in the blood start reacting, start forming the plasma cells. The T lymphocytes convert to the effector T cells, and these cells together further handle the pathogen and how to control the infection. And so cells are there which can, the T cells can kill the virally infected cells, and also the B cells convert to plasma cells, and there is antibody formation, and these antibodies again kill the virus. So this is how our immune system gears up. And it may be any pathogen, the same hypothesis applies, that this is what our immune system is meant to do. So there are different types of immunity. There is a humoral immunity and there is cell-mediated immunity. So today is not an immunology class, so I'm not going to discuss in detail, but we must remember that our immune system has all the kind of paraphernalia that it can interact with the pathogens, and there is an effector mechanism that starts functioning and controls the pathogen, and that's how the disease is brought under control. So all of you may have seen this slide multiple times. This was in circulation through WhatsApp, on the web, that how this infection happens and what is the stage. So if you look at this graph, so initially when we get to know the infection, actually the infection starts 2 weeks before we actually learn that there is an infection. So week minus two, the virus infects, and week minus one, the X starts happening in our body. And what happens is that there is the virus in the nasopharyngeal area and also in the oral cavity. So people started developing the assays, how and when can we detect. So all of you must have learned that there are different kinds of testing available to know how to detect this virus. So initially in the first week, there is a real increase in the virus load. And once the symptoms start, in that 1 week, the PCR test can be done and they will likely be positive. And if you follow the green bars, the nasopharyngeal swabs will indicate that how the virus can be detected, and gradually till week four and week five, the virus load goes down and we do not see the PCR positivity. Similarly, when the adaptive immune system takes over, the antibodies are formed. And once the antibodies are formed, the disease is coming under control, the virus is going low, and the antibody starts forming, and then we can detect the antibody. Once there is antibody, we are sure that now the antibodies can control the pathogen, and then they will be able to kill the virus. And the antibodies can be of different types. So the testing methodologies include the IgG and IgM antibody testing. So how was all of this possible? It was only possible due to the immense contribution of the scientists who developed the assays for detection as well as for management. And also the clinician scientists who developed the, tried the different drugs. And once the virus enters the immune system, there are different drugs that can act at different locations at the time of the entry that can be controlled. Once the virus is inside the cell, it can control. And also once the virus is maintaining in the body, so there are different drugs. You must have, all of you must have heard about hydroxychloroquine, chloroquine, leponavir, remdesivir, teclizumab, anti-IL-6. These were the several drugs that were tried, and there were several reports whether they are working good to control the virus or not. So all of this happened. And then again, there is a woman that comes into the limelight that because of all of these developments, the oldest person that could beat the virus was again a woman. So today is the day to celebrate women, and we must celebrate this occasion that the doctors were able to treat Mayra Bryans from Spain, and she was the oldest person who has been treated with all these diagnostic assays and the treatment availability. Now, ultimately, with all the treatments, the final goal was the development of vaccines, and which from the very beginning when the pandemic started, the scientists and the doctors and the hospitals, everybody geared up, and different types of vaccines were thought of how to control this viral infection. So let me just briefly tell you that there are different kinds of vaccines, and this virus can be tackled by the protein vaccines, or it can be by the whole virus vaccines. It could be attenuated or inactivated viruses. And the other methodology to develop vaccine is the viral vectors. It could be the non-replicating viral vectors or the replicating viral vectors. It could be nanoparticles and virus-like particles. Those vaccines can control. Or it could be nucleic acid-based vaccines, which could be the DNA vaccine or the RNA vaccine. So if we start from the top of this circle, from point one, to 2, to 3, to 4, 5, I've explained you what are the different kinds of mechanisms through which the vaccines can be developed. And also there is a therapy called the immune cell therapy, which can be managed through the dendritic cells and the cytotoxic T cells from the immune system. So these are the different options that were available, and globally people started making efforts how to develop a vaccine. Now, vaccine development is actually a very, very lengthy process. It would take years if one has to do a vaccine and with proper clinical trials. However, considering the seriousness of the and the number of individuals that were getting affected, and globally, it was very difficult due to these number of deaths that were happening, that both the scientists and the pharmaceutical companies and the administrative organizations decided to make the program in such a way that one could quickly develop a vaccine. Normally, it would take about 5 years, or could be even longer, up to 10 years. But then the organization fast-tracked various steps in the pandemic, and emergency use authorizations were given. So identifying a candidate for the vaccine, and then conducting the preclinical studies using the small animals, and then again conducting the preclinical studies using the monkeys, various studies, the safety, immunogenicity, and then doing the clinical phase one studies, the clinical trial phase two studies, where immune response is studied. So both safety and immune response could be sometimes combined. And that is what happened in this pandemic scenario. And then ultimately, after the phase three studies are done, the virus vaccines were developed. And now I'm going to highlight the women who contributed towards developing this vaccine. So all of you have heard of the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine. This is the lady, Dr. Sarah Gilbert. She's a British vaccinologist and the co-founder of the Vaccitech. She actually pioneered this work. She's a 58-year-old biologist, vaccinologist, and she's working at Oxford, who developed the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine. She is one of the most prominent figures now in terms of vaccine development. So this vaccine was up to 90% effective in the late stage of clinical trials. And she, along with another great scientist, Adrian Hill, strive to put together this foundation of the Oxford COVID Vaccine Foundation, and they eventually successfully patented. And this team was granted about 2.2 million euros from the UK National Institute of Health Research, and ultimately they came up with a good finding. So Sarah Gilbert has actually, personal life, has given birth to triplets in 1998. So her partner actually gave up the career to be a primary carer for the children, and finally, now when she developed the vaccine, her children also participated in the trials. That is the contribution she has made in this vaccine trial. And In one of the interviews to Bloomberg in Italy, she said her biggest strength lied in the fact that she knew how to balance the hopes needed to cheer up the distressed humankind with the reality. Nevertheless, she had been tirelessly working day and night, waking up at 4 in the morning, and since the outbreak, and then working for research and development of the vaccine. And here, you know, the vaccine is there, and we are have all people are now taking it. Coming to India, all of you are aware of Bharat Biotech company in located in down south, in headquartered at Hyderabad. And among this team of scientists who were working, led by Dr. Ella at Bharat Biotech, Dr. Sumati being the head of the R&D, she contributed a lot. And she's a PhD in life sciences from New Delhi, JNU. She's also a Commonwealth Scholarship holder. She worked at University College London and also at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. She leads the R&D wing of the Indian biotech company and developed the first indigenous vaccine, Covaxin, which all of us are very proud of. She's also a member of the core team of the scientists who were responsible for COVID vaccine development. And her contributions include development of chikungunya and Zika virus vaccines at the Bharat Biotech India Limited. And this is the vaccine many of you must have seen on television or may have already experienced when they have gone to take the vaccination. So this is the Indian vaccine against India COVID-19 draws a global attention. And this data that they have generated from India underlies impressive safety and immunogenicity profile of Covaxin and sparks the Lancet interest in publishing them. So therefore, this vaccine is now currently available, approved by the government of India for everybody to accept it. Going back to the Western world, this is another scientist from Pfizer, Dr. Katherine Janssen. She's the head of the vaccine research and development from Pfizer. She obtained a doctoral degree in microbiology, biochemistry, and genetics, a very good combination for somebody to do work in vaccinology. She's from, she started at Germany, and then she went to US. She studied at Cornell University, worked at Glaxo Institute of Molecular Biology, Switzerland, went back to US, University of Pennsylvania. And after she moved from Germany to US, she pursued her research on a yeast-based HPV vaccine. And there she developed a pneumococcal vaccine. She also contributed with Merck Research Labs and contributed towards rotavirus, zoster, measles, mumps, rubella. And she initiated and led the development of Gardasil. This is the first cervical cancer vaccine. So immense contributions in vaccine world. And she, at this biotech Pfizer vaccine combination, she worked towards this, and which leapfrogged over other Euro-American vaccines for its efficacy of about 95%, and was headed by Dr. Johnson. She had innumerable discussions with about 650 people on the Zoom meetings, and she coordinated the research programs on this mRNA approach with another great scientist. She's also listed in the few who have contributed a lot, Dr. Kathleen Caraico. So Dr. Kathleen Caraico, this is her picture. She's also from Germany. She worked with a German biotechnology company. She was actually born in Hungary. She did her PhD in Hungary, and she then served at the Hungarian Academy of Sciences. She was somehow laid off in 1985. Subsequently, she immigrated with her family, her husband and two daughters, and went to US. There she started her work at Temple University, and then moved to University of Pennsylvania, and then contributed towards this mRNA-based immunotherapies for cancer. And she began actually her work on, this is the company that in biotech, and she began her work on the mRNA-based gene therapy, something that has been the focus of her research ever since then. And she also worked along with the noted immunologist Drew Weissman, and she received, these two together received a patent for the discoveries regarding mRNA in 2012. She then accepted a job at the BioNTech as a senior vice president in charge of the company's mRNA project. And they partnered with Pfizer with this vaccine technology and planned for the global distribution. And this vaccine developed by another company called Moderna is also based on Dr. Caraico and Dr. Weissman's patent they got in 2012 about the mRNA. So women scientists contributing further again in Pfizer and biotech vaccine development. Dr. Olzem Turuki, She was also contributing, she has contributed towards this vaccine that is named Comirnaty. And this vaccine was developed in cooperation with Pfizer. And it is both the first vaccine to be authorized by the stringent regulatory mechanism for emergency use and was the first that cleared the regular use. She is co-founder and the chief medical officer of the BioNTech, a physician immunologist. She helped lead the development of mRNA-based individualized and off-the-shelf vaccines and other types of immunotherapies which are currently in clinical development. She leads the development of NBiotech, and the project was called Project Lightspeed because it was working at a very good speed. And the company's successful effort to develop and distribute the mRNA-based vaccine against COVID-19. And this historic achievement was completed in less than a year. So immense contribution. And she is actually working in a company and married to the co-founder, Dr. Uga Sahin. And both of them together are contributing immensely. This is Dr. Uga Sahin, contributing towards this, along with the other team members who co-founded this company and developed this vaccine. One another lady, colored woman, people said that in America, people were not accepting the vaccine. You all must have heard about it, that a lot of people were not believing that there is something called COVID infection and not following the normal, social distancing and mask wearing. And this woman, Dr. Kismekia Corbett, contributed a lot. And Anthony Fauci, Dr. Anthony Fauci, who's heading the vaccine program in US at the NIH, he praised her a lot that please believe the vaccine and believe the work of the scientists. And he praised her and said, the African woman scientist is in the forefront of creating this vaccine. Believe her. And Dr. Mr. Trump, the then president, also visited the laboratory and tried to know what is the science behind the vaccine. So she's one woman who has contributed. And another woman, basically from India, but she was working in US, Dr. Neeta Patel. She's a molecular scientist of a company called Novavax, and that's an American vaccine development company in Maryland. So another feat of her is that she's in the team, and that team is actually an all-female team. So she's a woman leading an all-female team. Their vaccine is still in the final trial stages, not in the market as yet, but the chief scientist and her boss, Gail Smith, called on Neeta and said, she's an immigrant from Gujarat, a genius and an invaluable person. She hails from Gujarat and she went through a struggling time in her childhood. She was just 4 years old when the family had experienced poverty, and her father nearly died of TB. And then he motivated her to become a doctor and persuaded her that you must find a cure for tuberculosis. And consequent to that motivation from her father, she has worked and she has led the race of developing a vaccine, which is soon going to be in the market. She has also actually contributed in identifying the precise locations where in the proteins the antibodies can bind and kill this virus, those neutralizing antibodies, that antibodies that can neutralize the virus. So this Novavax results are not yet published. However, there are very promising results, and soon we might see a vaccine that is a product that is the contribution of Dr. Neeta Patel from India, but working in Maryland in US. Going further, more women. Lisa Jackson, a senior investigator at the Kaiser Permanente Washington Health Research Institute, she headed the NIH Moderna phase 3 trial in the US. The Time magazine actually quoted her work, and they said on the, that unexpectedly high efficacy of the vaccine developed by the NIH and Moderna. The COVID-19 vaccine known as mRNA-1273, many of you must have heard about this product, held an outstanding efficacy rate of 94%. She also oversaw the phase 1 clinical trials for vaccine and inoculated herself the study participants. And she says that the company gives a nearly unlimited potential to address the vaccine effectiveness, safety questions of national and international importance. Further to this, coming to Dr. Henneke Schutmacher. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing the names well, but she's a scientist who was contributed from the company Johnson & Johnson. And this was in the news and was mentioned as she's a scientist with one of the world's most important jobs, creating a potential vaccine. And she's actually a Dutch virologist, professor of virology at Amsterdam. She's the global head of the viral vaccine discovery and translational medicine at Johnson & Johnson. And this 57-year-old lady has led the vaccine development trials in Netherlands and continuing her research on the HIV vaccine. She's actually a mother of three children. She maturely spoke in length about what's there in store for us in future. And in one of her interviews, she said, "I really hope that we will learn lessons from this period, not only from a virological point of view, but also in terms of how we choose to live our lives. All of us know that we have to be very conscious in terms of health and hygiene." And that's what she said, that we have a big lesson to learn. And during one of her conversations with the Prime Minister of Netherlands, she said, "The treatment saves lives, but vaccine saves population. When you get a vaccine, it's not just for yourself. It helps ensure that the transmission chain stops with you and that helps keep your loved ones safe and healthy." And I think it is time all of us follow this, make this as our mantra, and follow and take the vaccine and stop the transmission chain at the earliest possible. And she again gave comments that this time will pass, and good that you can do for your kids in the meantime is that be there for them, take away their sorrows, take away their anxiety, try and make some good memories now, and this is a priceless moment. And she mentioned that she had large Zoom meetings. She used to interact with more than 50 people at a time. And she just loved seeing that even during the Zoom meeting, people had their kids in their laps. They used to wave on the cameras, but they were all working towards development of a vaccine, discussing how to go about on the Zoom meetings. Some people in the lab, some people sitting at home, some people in the office, but finally contributing. So knowing that we are looking on a vaccine, we could be a part of the solution is a proud moment for her. These are her comments, which are very inspiring. Coming to this part of the world, not from the America to the Asian regions and to Russia. So we all know that Russia has developed the Sputnik vaccine, which is now also going to be available in India through Dr. Reddy's lab. And again here, we see Dr. Elena. She is the one who actually led the team as the chief researcher for development of this vaccine. In June, their institute at the Health Ministry of Russian Federation registered a combined phase 1, phase 2 trial on a vaccine called Gamcovid-Baclio. And they plan to test that in 38 volunteers. So right in 6 months of the pandemic, they were doing the phase 1, phase 2 trial. And they said that vaccine is made from an adenovirus, a harmless cold virus, and it's carrying a coronavirus gene, which is also similar to what the AstraZeneca and Johnson & Johnson are using in their vaccine. And this technology is relatively new, but this is the first adenovirus vaccine for any disease that was approved was Ebola actually. And then they have come up with this. So the Russian Sputnik vaccine. So let me just tell you that while all of these discoveries were going on, the journals and the scientists and the community was also looking at what is happening with the fraternity and also looking at the gender equity. So this was an opinion in one of the very high impact factor journals called PNAS. And this opinion was written by the authors from multiple groups. And they mentioned that in the wake of COVID-19, the academia needs to know the solutions. So if you carefully look at the picture, the virus is a big load on all the human beings. I really, my heart goes to the credit to this image made by Dave Cutler. This is in the article that you can see the virus size and you see all the men carrying the virus load, whereas you see that the load that a woman has to handle is much higher. But women in all sectors, even in personal life, in professional life, as a clinician, as a scientist, as a nurse, I think have handled the burden much more higher, and we are all proud of it. So many women academicians have, you know, they are likely to bear a greater burden during this pandemic. That's what this article mentioned, that academia needs to enact solutions to retain and promote the women faculty who already face disparities regarding merit, tenures, and promotions. no matter how much we say that women are contributing, but they still go through a difficult time, and there are issues and gender equity is not being mentioned. The burden will be even heavier for women who face intersection systems of oppression, such as the ethnicity, race, sexual orientation, gender, age, economic class, dependent status, and or ability. So I think the academia needs to pay attention how these women can be benefited. And this article also talked about that we need to have an honest conversation with the academia that can mitigate this bias, you know, that the academia discussions, you know, can be. So Jessica has very beautifully put around this how the honest, you know, conversations can begin. And this, you know, I can tell you that the conversation have to start. There has to be, you know, one has to start asking right questions. There has to be a starting point for doing this, be it teaching, it could be research, it could be service, that how many courses are being transitioned to an online mode, how many courses were there transitioned to an online mode during spring of this matter, did the faculty member mentor the students, were there women contributing or not, was SS, you know, the research labs, what's happening, what is the, you know, the startup funding available for people to work, did the faculty contribute to the department university initiatives related to COVID? Did they contribute to public discussions? And all of these, you know, the invited seminars, the conferences, the research programs, the duties towards handling, all of these need to be, you know, discussed at a right forum. And then we need to understand that the evaluation committees need to be diverse. They should include women and faculty of all color. The committees need to be informed. They understand the inequality and inequity at their institutions. The committees need to be transparent. The detailed plans to promote gender equity, race parity, be proactive, distribute a clear and documented procedure for reevaluation, and then be trained, understand how COVID differently impacts the careers of women. So I think these kind of discussions have to go on. But despite all of this gender equality, inequality, I can tell you that women went on to contribute. And now coming back to our hometowns in India, very early in the pandemic stage, this was in the news in the print, that the doctors, the IAS officers, the scientists, and these were five women who were leading the India's fight against COVID. Dr. Priya, Dr. Preeti Sudhan, Madam Preeti Sudhan from Ministry, Dr. Nivedita, Dr. Renu Swaroop, and I will highlight their contributions. And this was their big contribution that they made towards somehow, you know, controlling the pandemic, be it administrative positions, be it scientists, and be it at the bench. And then not only these great women, I would really like to emphasize that youngsters in our country, the PhD students, especially the girls, I'm sure a lot of boys also contributed, but the girls did come forward despite the pandemic and the control, and they contributed a lot. And I think all the students, the PhD students, they were only looking at, when they close their eyes or open their eyes, they could always see all around them the virus, as you see in this picture. And all these students, they were, you know, it's their career, they have PhD programs, they have their, you know, objectives to fulfill, but they paused all of that and they came forward to lead the COVID-19 teams and their supervisors and their mentors and their, you know, institutions in working towards. So this was in the press that the students were working. And this was also published by Science Wire, that how these youngsters are contributing to India's, and they are actually, they label them as the COVID-19 response. Young scientists are among India's unsung heroes. The PhD students in India, they're often ridiculed by their choices. People laugh at them. Oh, you are doing a PhD? It's not a big career. It's not a great career. I don't know what's your future. Sometimes by their own families, sometimes by others, trolls on social media, labeled as parasites. But no matter what, our students in this country have contributed. And this particular article mentioned about the contribution of students from CCMB Hyderabad, IGIB New Delhi, from ICER Pune, from Indian Institute of Science of Bangalore, and I'm sure there are hundreds of other institutions in our country. And these students work towards modeling the spread of the disease, estimating the healthcare resources, isolating and growing the virus in the labs, sequencing the genome of the viruses, developing the diagnostic testing, and also contributing to the technological innovations, developing the kits, new materials for PPE, low-cost ventilators. And I must say here, it may be the girls or the boys, but the PhD students did contribute a lot. And one of the articles highlighted about this girl, Bani Jolly. She's a computer science engineer. She moved on to biology, and she's presently working at, you know, the IGIB Institute, which is a CSIR funded institute. And she just was in the news in this article saying that she's an asset to the pandemic for her contributions to the lab. She said, "My work at the moment is to accumulate the available data. And these data sets are online and predict the evolutionary history of the virus." So the team led by Dr. Vinod Skaria, these all students were working with them, and they really immensely contributed right from home or in the labs. And she specifically, when this article was published, it was on Twitter, and in a day, they got 13,000 views. And Bani mentioned while this publication that, "Please put a picture of my desk that I'm really missing." And right below, you see the picture of her desk, which she could not go to the lab, but she contributed in sitting at home. So coming back to the senior, she also, all of you must have heard a lot about her. She is the Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology. She herself is a PhD in genetics and plant engineering, and she did her postdoctoral studies at the UK, Johns Innes Center. She's actually contributed a lot as an administrator. She's responsible from the Department of Biotechnology, and she is responsible for scaling up manufacturing capacity of the startups that made the low-cost testing kits and the ventilators. Her ministry motivated all the IIT incubators to focus on research and development of these portable ventilators, the genome sequencing, the isolation of the strain or from the blood sample. She's also a managing director for this BIRAC program, the Biotechnology Industry Research Assistance. And she has been a very, very good supporter, fervent supporter of women scientists and has been very closely involved in several initiatives related to women in science. Even prior to the COVID pandemic came up, she really has been contributing to women working in promoting the women in scientists. And the other most popular name all of you must have heard is a dear friend, Dr. Nivedita. She's working at the ICMR. She hails from Lucknow, and you know, presently she has been really contributing a lot on behalf of ICMR. She did her MBBS at Delhi in the Lady Hari Medical College and went on to do a PhD in the Center for Molecular Medicine at Jawaharlal Nehru University. She presently is the scientist and in charge of the virology unit at the ICMR headquarters and has played a major role, and I would highlight some of her contributions. She was also on the cover page of Vogue magazine as the COVID warriors. And it's a proud moment to have women being projected for their contributions. She actually led the teams for establishment of the laboratories. All of you may be aware that when the pandemic was open to the world, in India, we didn't have laboratories that could detect and do the RT-PCR. And our country, she led this program, and she, with her seniors and administrators from ICMR and Dr. Balram Bhargav and all the seniors and the government, the ICMR was able to establish more than 2,350 laboratories till February. And they were ensuring high quality testing in the viral labs. They were doing inspections, the troubleshooting, organizing the training, implementing quality control programs, and formulating these programs and advising how to conduct validations. The RT-PCR, the TrueNAT protocol, the CBNAT protocols, and she has contributed formulating the first in world protocol for validation of the rapid antigen test and implementing the use in India for validation. She coordinated this initiation of RT-PCR labs and far ahead to remote areas like Ladakh, Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, as well as in other northeastern states, Lakshadweep and Andaman Islands. And they formulated these protocols, and ultimately these diagnostic kits were actually validated, and 70% of the products were indigenous and in line with the government's Atmanirbhar Bharat program. They had, she coordinated the efforts from the ICMR related to development of COVID-19 vaccines, the preclinical clinical studies of Covaxin and Covishield, as well as other vaccines that are in the pipeline, the Novavax, the Zydela vaccine, and also in the nationwide genome sequencing. So immense contribution from Dr. Nivedita. We are also, all of us, I think, are aware of another great scientist, Dr. Gagandeep Kang, who made India proud. She is an ex-executive director of the Translational Health and Science Technology Institute in Faridabad. She is the first woman actually to be picked up as a fellow of the London's Royal Society. And this was a very proud moment. It was in the news a few months ago, last year. And she actually has contributed a lot in vaccine development. And the rotavirus vaccine was actually a big contribution from her. She's a medical graduate and a PhD from CMC Vellore. And she also had her postdoctoral training in Houston. And Dr. Kang has co-authored now a book, Till We Win, India's Fight Against the COVID-19 Pandemic. And she co-authored this book in along with Dr. Chandrakant Laharia and Professor Randeep Guleria, director of my institute, Orion Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. And this book has been published, and I would encourage all of you to buy this book. It's from Penguin Random House India. And she's also serving on the boards of several vaccine development programs. Now coming to the laboratories, National Institute of Virology is in the news, and nothing new for me to mention. Director of this institute, ICMR Institute, is Dr. Priya Abraham. She and her team led in the isolation of the SARS-CoV-2 virus. And that's where the work started. Once they were able to isolate the virus, people could characterize and start doing the basic research on how to control this pandemic. Dr. Priya is an 81 batch MD, and she's also a PhD in biology from CMC. And she was former head of the clinical virology at CMC Vellore. And then she's gone on to be the leader at National Institute of Virology as a director. She's particularly interested, initially she worked on hepatitis and HPV, and she has an illustrious career working on viral infections. So her immense contribution in being able to isolate this virus, and also her co-worker and another great scientist, Dr. Priya, Dr. Pragya Yadav. And she is the laboratory supervisor of the containment laboratory at the National Institute of Virology. And she, along with Dr. Priya Abraham, were the first ones to publish this article in Indian Journal of Medical Research about the isolation of the SARS-CoV-2 from the clinical samples in India. So they are all, Dr. Nivedita and all of them are part of the ICMR rapid response team, and they work towards the COVID pandemic. Another woman, I think it also was in the news quite a lot, Dr. Minal Bhosle, again from Maharashtra, from Pune. She's a virologist who actually developed the first coronavirus testing kit. So she was, a lot appreciated because she was in her late stage of her pregnancy. And this 31-year-old Dr. Minal, despite her late stage of pregnancy, went in the lab, worked towards it, and finally came up with the, before delivering her baby, she delivered the testing kit in a record time of 6 weeks. And she's been a student at Pune, and she worked at the National Institute of Virology and then joined the MyLab and head of the R&D laboratory where this testing kit was first developed. So a lot of Indian women developing, contributing towards pandemic management. I would go further. You see a small picture, but this lady has also contributed a lot, Dr. Anshu Bhardwaj. I had a privilege of talking to her a few days ago, and I was amazed at the contribution that they have made. She actually looks into the chemical compounds that can be used to control the pandemic. So in terms of therapeutics, they have made a big contribution that not much was known, how the doctors are going to be treating this disease. And her group, she led and she collaborated with several other organizations. And she, they made a team, and they looked at what was the available literature on the drugs that can be, the chemical compounds that can be useful for treatment. And, she All this scattered information was collected by her, by the team that they had developed, and they made a database, and a, you know, where all the structures of about more than 750 compounds is known. And this program is open to anybody or anyone interested in working towards drug repurposing or drugs required for handling COVID. And I think she immensely contributed in, you know, talking to the companies who were having the softwares that can be used. So below are mentioned like 5-6 international companies. Then she talked to the Ministry of Human Resource Development Innovation Cell, the CDAC, and, you know, brought them all together. She was a team leader of this hackathon that they had. And then she ensured that all the people who participated in the hackathon were able to use these softwares which are available from these companies. And I think what she mentioned is that 150 crore worth softwares are freely available for the hackathon members to access and contribute towards finding out the targets and the drugs and the inhibitors that can actually be likely, you know, therapeutic potential for the SARS-CoV-2. And she mentioned that, you know, already you are, all of you are aware that the Solidarity clinical trial, all the treatments, the remdesivir, hydroxychloroquine, lopinavir, interferon, the trial reported that there was little effect or no effect on the overall mortality. So there is a need for the community to come up and develop newer products. So Dr. Anshu has contributed in that. Then we have a few of my personal contacts, Dr. Preeti Chavan from ACTRAC Tata. She just informed that they also geared up being the laboratory head in the management of their you know, COVID protocols, the staff morale to be increased, the infection control policies, training the people in the institute, clinical management of the disease, doing the laboratory assays like anti-IL-6 or looking at IL-6 levels, neutralizing antibodies, then contact management, vaccination, and also went on to publish some papers. Dr. Kulkarni from again from Mumbai, working at the Radiation Center, and she's working on development of liposomal and nanoparticle based vaccine formulations. And we hope that she's successful in her protocol program. Dr. Jyoti, again, another woman contributor from ACTRAC, Dr. Shanti Mukherjee, Dr. Babita, Dr. Vidula from the Ayurvedic institutions. And all of these women have contributed a lot towards the COVID management. And these are different drug compounds that these people are trying, and along with the Ayurvedic Ayush ministry. So this is an institute I would like to mention, that Brahm Prakash Ayurvedic Charak Sanstha in Delhi. And they were the first autonomous Ayurvedic medical college that came up and you know, worked towards the COVID management. And they have made immense contributions. If you see that the kind of number of patients that they've handled, admitted in the hospital, the casualties, the number of tests that they have done, the rapid antigen, the RT-PCR, a lot of you know, protocol management that they have done using the Kavath and you know, these compounds called Agasthi, Haritaki, Sitopaladi, and Shanshamani, and Yavni Arak, and all of these are being developed. So immense contributions from a lot of women within India and abroad. And I would just now briefly touch upon just 2 days ago, I heard an oration from our ICMR DG, and he mentioned that ICMR has gone through a tough time, and he compiled the work done by our country scientists. And this is the data that in India about the you know, genetic sequences that were of the virus that were studied. And we can see that there are so many clades of the viruses studied in so many geographic areas all over the country. And that's how the ICMR has been able to develop further protocols because of this background information available. So many sero surveys, Bhargav sir mentioned during his oration that there were 3 major surveys covering major parts of the country, and they were able to identify how many people are, you know, having the antibodies and what is the you know, immunity level of the Indian population. And finally, that these contributions from the institutions in India have led to development of the vaccines that I mentioned. The Indian invented vaccines are the Bharat Biotech vaccine, the Zydus Cadila is coming up with this, And then the Serum Institute, the AstraZeneca vaccine, which was being produced, and the Serum Institute is the biggest manufacturer, going to be producing more vaccines for us, different brands. The Genova vaccine is coming up. They will be developed. Dr. Reddy's lab is going to be providing the Sputnik, the non-replicating viral vectors, and so many partnerships by DVT with our organization in the industry has led to these different vaccines, the Sputnik, the AstraZeneca. However, you know, if you look at the global scenario as to how many people have actually at the present moment got the approval for vaccine and are actually trying, if you look at it, not many countries have been able to get the vaccine still. We are fortunate that we have the vaccine. And if you look at the global map here, that about over 30% of population getting vaccine is only limited to few regions, geographic regions, about less than 30%, between 10 to 30% in few parts of the world, like UK and Bahrain and all, and rest of the world, less than 10% population has still got the vaccine. So there is a big challenge. We need to go further. And not only that, this is, you know, I'm talking about another lady, Dr. Gilley from Canada. They have developed now, or in the process of developing, a nasal vaccine. She, along with this scientific officer and her co-founder in the company, they have now developed another program. And very soon, we will have not the injectables, but probably a nasal vaccine that might be available to the community. So work in progress being developed. So with all of these, contributions made, but I must tell you that the impact has been huge on various fronts. So this was one of the articles that was published during the mid last year, 2020, that, you know, the schools were closed, the universities are closed, and the universities will never be the same, you know, as long as the coronavirus is going to be there. There were virtual classrooms. You know, there were difficulties in people attending the classes due to the internet availability, and the science has totally changed. So if you look at the left part of the screen, this is the original. People would smoothly study and get the degrees, but here is a puzzle and it keeps moving from one part to the other, and how we are going to handle the pandemic and also the education. Not only the universities, the schools are not going to be the same. Schools are now reopening, but in several parts of the world, I think the children also have to wear the masks, be very careful, maintain social distancing, and experience this kind of isolation, which they have never felt. Again, coming to scientific meetings, we all scientists and doctors and clinicians were very privileged that we used to travel to different parts of the world, within India and abroad, meet our peer groups, discuss our work. And those were the days when, you know, before the pandemic, we used to be on the stage talking and we had a big audience sitting in front of us. Now it is different. Like I'm talking today, that I'm at home, and on the screen I have hundreds of you who are participants in today's webinar. And this is a most common scene nowadays. In the last 1 year, we have gone through a lot of webinars and we've still interacted with each other, women, men, students, you know, administrators, everybody has, you know, shifted from this domain to the right part and still contributing towards science and handling the pandemic. The biggest problem that we are now facing is that because all financial divisions had to divert the funding. So, you know, it's a budget breaker, this footing moment. However, the, you know, the research has to go on. So previously we had, you know, money, dollars or funds coming into us. And now this funnel has turned upside down. So the money is now less for research. And the researchers have to work a lot, and the burden has to be handled in a different way, where we can handle the pandemic and also continue our research in our already focused areas, which we were defined, not everybody is working in the field of immunology or virology, and those research areas have to go on medical research. But due to this funnel turning upside down, we will be facing difficult times. But I'm sure the community will continue to do science. And you know how one can learn and teach science is very well projected in this picture made by Robert Neuberger. It was published in one of the Nature articles that you have to read, you have to learn, climb up the platform, and then you have to jump into a pool of knowledge. And unless we jump into this pool and try to figure out what are the publications available, what I need to focus, and that's how the scientists have been doing. And it's a very difficult task to think, to reach from, start climbing the ladder. Not everybody is able to reach the stage and jump into the pool. But I hope that we all can still do this and have the fun of jumping into the pool and coming up with the you know, outcomes that can benefit the community. After all, we are we have our social responsibility to work for our fellow human beings. So this is my mentor, Professor Mehra. He was giving a talk somewhere, and I borrowed from his talk the slide, and I have copied his slide, and he highlighted the point that, you know, that this is a PubMed where we look at the international literature. And in this COVID time, you know, the publication has gone up like 30-fold. Like we used to have in 20 years, there were like 47,000 papers published. And they used to be like maybe probably at an average of close to 200 papers a month, and which has gone up in the COVID time in the past 8 months to about like over close to 6,000 publications, and over 50% of them are in relation to COVID immunity and vaccines. So this is the extent of the work, and this is a slide from September 2020, and I'm sure now the numbers have gone high. So you can imagine how much people are contributing towards handling the pandemic. And all the students, the youngsters, and the fellow scientists and clinicians who are in the audience, I would like to say that everybody is contributing. Some people do more, some people less. Someone's contributions are not recognized, some are. So everyone needs to learn to speak up for themselves about their contributions and their authorship, that their contributions are well recognized. So this was also one of the Nature articles that probably written by someone who actually lost a recognition for the contributions. So do remember that you have to ensure that whatever you are contributing is acknowledged. And I'm sure the mentors will acknowledge all the youngsters and their fellow colleagues and keep publishing data that we will learn. So I would like to thank you all for your patient hearing. And since the Valentine Day is coming up, I would like to convey that all women, be your own Valentine, be yourself a Valentine for yourself, like what is projected in this picture. And you know, be proud of the contributions that you are making, and take initiatives to if you have not done till now, to go forward. And my Valentines are my two PhD students from my department, Akanksha and Sanskriti, who helped me prepare a few slides, and I took that and then added on, and finally landed up with this presentation that I could make to you and discuss about the women who have contributed towards the COVID pandemic. I once again thank for this opportunity given to me, the Vice Chancellor Sir and the Vignan Institute. And I appreciate all of you for your patient hearing. And I'm happy to answer the questions, if any. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for such an informative session. Thank you so much, ma'am. Now I would like to request Dr. Prashant Surwajadla, Birla Institute of Scientific Research, to make a quick remark and share his words with us. Over to you, sir. Dr. Prashant.
Yeah, yes, please. Yeah. Thank you so much for this wonderful talk, ma'am. In fact, you know, the highlight of this particular talk, you know, if I can just, you know, put it, There are two Umas here. One is Huma, the host, and the other one is Huma, the speaker. And interestingly, if we can really think about these two wonderful Dr. Umas, Uma in Sanskrit, you know, means the nation. And there's no doubt in saying that Dr. Uma Kanga's talk is an excellent one. In fact, it's a kind of a wonderful talk which I've ever witnessed, not only in recent times, but ever witnessed, I would say. Madam has wonderfully taken us through the accomplishments of all the women scientists, if we can really take. I don't know how much time she would have really spent, you know, looking into these particular things. If we can really look into one of the other accomplishments, if we can see her status quo in terms of encouraging her PhD fellows as well, I think, you know, it's absolutely no par excellence. And if we can thank Dr. Uma Kanga, I think the best way to thank her is by giving, you know, standing ovation. I hope you all agree. It's not only the wonderful standing ovation that we can give to eminent women scientists like Dr. Uma Kanga, but all the speakers and all the attendees over here, who are many of them the women scientists, who have really accomplished wonderful successes. And they have been a kind of an inspiration, not just for their students, but also their men who might really be in their houses, who would really be wonderfully, you know, inspired taking their wonderful accomplishments. One final word, madam, I think, you know, COVID has really been a kind of a blessing in disguise, which we always discussed. And I think this opportunity has really allowed the children to be along with the parents, and as well as the husband to be also along with their or with his or her spouse. I think in that particular process, I would without any hesitation say that the husbands or the male counterparts in the family are absolutely privileged to have women in their house. Thank you so much, ma'am, for this, you know, wonderful talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant, for the kind words. And I actually wanted to make a remark at the end that all of the women, I think, have been able to contribute because of the support that they have from the men in their family. I am very privileged to have my husband and my children help me do that. And I'm sure all of these women, a few of them I mentioned, that their husband actually left their career and became the, you know, people person who could look after their children. And that's how I think the women were able to contribute. So it's a you know, collaborative effort, and it's you know, all of us work together. But since it is a day for women celebration, I had to highlight the work of the women. I'm sure one day we will celebrate men's contribution also and talk about it. But definitely behind every great man, there's a great woman. And behind every great woman, there's a great man. And that's how we are able to contribute. So I thank the university again, and thank you, Dr. Prashant, for actually introducing me to this university and giving me this opportunity. So you also contribute in a way doing that. Thank you so much. I learned a lot during you know, preparing this presentation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Now I'd like to call upon Dr. Sharaza to give the vote of thanks. Over to Sharada Ma.
Thank you, Meenakshi. So it's been a wonderful session. We really enjoyed listening to Dr. Uma Kanga. She has given a very comprehensive and a very exhaustive talk, chronicling all the efforts made by women since the pandemic broke out, and of course, even before that. So my sincere and heartfelt thanks to our eminent speaker, Dr. Uma Kanga, scientist from Indian Institute of Medical Sciences. And she has made it very extremely inspiring, because she has also been given some anecdotes and narratives, little bit of information about the personal struggles of the women scientists as well. So this is a message for all the participants, our young participants, that they should not give in to struggles, okay? They should not give up and they should persevere like all those wonderful women scientists have done. So I thank Dr. Uma Kanga once again for making so much effort in giving, in putting this presentation together and giving us this inspiring talk. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
I would also like to place on record our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. M.B.S. Prasad, sir, for giving us a wonderful opening remark and for all the encouragement he has been giving us in willing to grace the event. Thank you very much, sir. I thank my colleagues from the Civil Services Academy, who are supported by the head of training, Professor C. Raghav Rao. I thank the team, Mr. Wiggins, Uma, the coordinator, Meenakshi, and the rest of the team for organizing this wonderful talk. And it is a very contemporary topic, which we all enjoyed listening to. I would also like to place on record Dr. Jalja from the Department of Biotechnology for her support in helping us to have and invite Dr. Uma Kanga here. So she made, with her connections, she made the invitation possible.
Thank you, Dr.
I thank Dr. Usha Rani, the chairperson of Women Empowerment and Development Cell, for her guidance and continuous support in helping us to host this event. But last but not the least, I thank our young students for their interest and for ardently listening to the talk. And I'm sure that there's a great takeaway for them, for all of them from this whole event. So I thank you all once again. Thank you very much. And I'm looking forward to more of such enriching talks. Thank you all once again for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Uma ma'am.
Thank you, everyone. With this, we wind up today's session. Thank you, everyone.